Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to my channel. My name is Gavin Fish. I really appreciate that you take the time to check out this video, and I'm very grateful. On my channel over the last week or so, we've got a lot of new subscribers, a lot of new viewers, so thank you very much. If you're not a subscriber and you think I've earned it and you want to see more content like this, I would appreciate it if you would go ahead and subscribe. Today we're going to continue talking about the case of Gabby Petito, and I have to say, one of the things that it's hard to say it this way, but what I love about this case is that we're all focused in the right place. We're focused on the victim here. Obviously, part of our focus has to be on finding Brian Laundry, right, who is on the run, but I'm glad that as web sleuths, as internet sleuths, we're keeping our eye on the ball, right? And that is finding justice for a victim of a horrible homicide, Gabby Petito. Yesterday, I took a little break. I completely disconnected from the internet. I didn't look at the case at all. I just needed a breather, spend some time with my family. And this morning, I got back to it. And I found a couple more documents that I think that we should talk about. Now, this doesn't mean that those documents weren't already out there. It's just that I found them this morning, and I want to talk about them a little bit. If you're new to my channel, kind of the thing about me is that I really don't want to chase theories and ideas, even though those are important because those lead to investigations, right? You have to have those things. What I try to focus on really are documents and things that we can look at and kind of dissect and tear apart. So that's what I've got for you today. I've got a couple of things that I want to show you. I think where I want to start is I found this picture on Facebook. Well, I actually found it on a news story referring back to a Facebook post, and they had a screenshot of the Facebook post. This is purportedly posted by a man named Mike Schmidt. Mike is Gabby's uncle. So he posted these handwritten notes of a timeline as he remembers it or as he sees it. So most of these things we know, right? The domestic abuse report was on 8/12. Obviously, right? So on 8/12 is when the domestic was reported. I've actually got some audio that we're going to listen to about that. On 8/24, left hotel in Salt Lake City. I think he's talking about Gabby, and then in Grand Teton on the 25th, told a friend through Snapchat on the 27th, she was headed to Yellowstone. And then the last text from her phone was on the 30th saying no service in Yosemite. I think we know now she was never in Yosemite. So was it her who sent that? I think not. The thing that most, I guess, struck me about this is up here in the upper right hand corner, Brian went to Florida 8/17 to 8/23. Now, the conversations around that I've seen online, people are asking, they're speculating. And I just said, I don't like to speculate. I like to look at the documents. But this is something that I think is important. Did Brian, after he checked out of that hotel or that motel down in Moab, well, it was 5 days later, but at some point did he return to Florida? Maybe he and Gabby weren't getting along. He thought he needed a breather. I don't know. So we're going to have to figure out how to prove that, if there's like a flight itinerary or witnesses or something like that. So that was the thing that really struck me there, is that Brian went to Florida. And then the other thing is that last text from 8:30. Saying no service in Yosemite. So this just screams of a cover-up, right? This is, I believe, in my opinion, it's Brian Laundry trying to cover up the fact that Gabby Petito was dead. In fact, that 8/27 told a friend that she's headed to Yellowstone. I think by by 8:26, Gabby was already dead, if I have my timeline correct. That's what I think. So I would love to hear your comments on this. If you guys have any ideas about that, or if you can point me in the direction that I should go to find more documents, I really love that. And that's happened a couple times on this channel. If you have some place where I can go and look to find corroboration, or maybe, some kind of, way to disprove anything that is here, I would love to see those documents. So please put those in the comments below. The next thing I wanted to talk about today is the Moab police released the audio of the dispatch call. Remember that 911 call that was made by a man named Christopher, or Chris, told Moab police dispatch that he saw a male hit a female, and they were in a white Ford Transit van, black ladder on the back. So we know it's Brian Laundry and Gabby Petito. Well, Moab police has released that dispatch audio, and I want to play that. And so have a listen.
1063, attempt to locate. Continuing attempt to locate, time lapse of about probably 40 seconds, RP states, seen a male hit a female domestic. He got into a white Ford Transit van, has a black ladder on the back, Florida plate of Quebec Fox Tango Golf 03. The van turned right onto Main Street from Moonflower Market and headed north onto Main Street. 1638.
228 out at Moonflower.
1641.
So, 228, do you have a phone number for the RP? Maybe you're still landline and a location where our victim's at?
Phone number is... Name's... I'm not sure that, but the female who got hit, they both, the male and the female, both got into the van and headed north.
58, 59.
Okay, so I guess why that is important, why it's important to me, is that the officers who were dispatched, who eventually found Brian Laundry and Gabby Petito, knew that a witness had said that the male had hit the female. And when we look at the badge cam, actually, when we listen to the badge cam, they were very, very interested in scratches and stuff that were on his face. And they didn't see any, evidence that Gabby had been hit. And so they made the call that they weren't going to cite or arrest because there wasn't any proof that there was domestic violence there besides the scratches on Brian, and he was just kind of talking them, he was minimizing them, I guess is the best way to say that. And the Moab police have been kind of called to the carpet on this because, and you'll see this in a previous video of mine, everybody believes, or I shouldn't generalize that way, people have said that it was their responsibility to make an arrest or make a citation. And had they done that, maybe Gabby would still be alive today, because maybe parents would be alerted to the real problems here. So I have that Utah law available to me. This is the code that has to do with domestic violence cases. And I'm not going to dig really deep into this, guys, because I have a previous video on this. But if we go to paragraph 2B1, if the peace officer has probable cause to believe that there will be continued violence against the alleged victim, or if there is evidence that the perpetrator has either recently caused serious bodily injury or used a dangerous weapon in the domestic violence offense, the officer shall arrest and take the alleged perpetrator into custody and may not utilize the option of issuing a citation under the section. So that's pretty specific. I mean, they have to have probable cause that there will be continued domestic violence, and or that there was a dangerous weapon that was used. So dangerous weapon could be, you know, it could be a gun, could be, you know, something to hit somebody with. So the idea that they were mandated to make an arrest, they're only mandated to make an arrest in that case, right? If those two things if one of those two things are true, there's probable cause to believe there will be continued violence or a dangerous weapon was used. In section C here, if a peace officer does not immediately exercise arrest powers or initiate criminal proceedings by citation or otherwise, blah, 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 blah. That's not the one. Three, if a law enforcement officer receives complaints of domestic violence from two or more opposing persons, the officer shall evaluate each complaint separately to determine who is the predominant aggressor. This is one of those things that, that people were talking about, you know, who's the predominant aggressor here. And typically that's the man, not always, but, let's see, the officer shall evaluate, determine who the predominant aggressor was. If the officer determines that one person was the predominant physical aggressor, the officer need not arrest the other person alleged to have committed domestic assault. So, you know, that's kind of the thing, is they don't have to arrest both of them. I'm trying to find, as I've read this, you know, I just feel like they really didn't have enough to make an arrest. And officers get to exercise discretion on whether they will cite people or not. So anyway, I just, even having that, the dispatch audio, and even the Moab police officers knowing that there's a witness that said that Brian Laundry had hit Gabby Petito, I think that it's probably reasonable for them to conclude what they concluded, no matter how sad and how just, this is the understatement of the year, but how unfortunate it was that ended up happening. I'm probably going to be unpopular for that opinion, but that's where I see it. I don't want to jump on the bandwagon of blaming the Moab police. From what I can tell from watching everything, they did act professionally and they did reach conclusions that were reasonable, I guess. Beat me up in the comments if you think I'm wrong. Okay. The next thing that I want to show you that I have found is, and this may seem kind of trite, but I think that this is actually pretty important. I want to talk about it a little bit. And that is the missing person report that was filed on the 11th of September in Suffolk County, the police department. As I've gone through this, I don't know if you guys have seen this. I'll put a link down in the description where you can download this and check it out. You know, it describes her, how you can contact her, all that stuff, gave cell phone number, which we all know now. It's redacted, but we all know it. But when I came down here to the accounts section, this jogged my memory, guys. So from the moment that Gabby Petito was reported missing, police knew about her Capital One checking account and credit card. And this becomes important because later on, there's actually a warrant for Brian Laundrie's arrest in connection with this account. It jogged my memory. People have been asking, how long have the police known about this, and are they able to get access and all this stuff? And I'm going to jump into a little bit of speculation here, but it's like educated speculation. I'm just going to go over to, this. Okay. This is a video that I did on a victim named Denise Kathleen Anderson. And I did this over on the Solve Crime. It used to be called Solve Crimes with Rick and Gavin when Rick and I started together. Now it's Solve Crimes TV. This victim, Denise Anderson, just disappeared off the streets of Sacramento, California. In the video, we talk about how, like, it was crazy how she just disappeared and nobody looked for 2 years. But in the articles that we found, we discovered that police, one of the reasons that they figured that this was fishy was because she had never touched her accounts after she went missing. And that jogged my memory when I took a look and I found the missing persons report, right? This, I believe that police probably had access to that Capital One account from the very beginning, from the 11th of September. And the reason that I believe that is because of the age of Gabby Petito. So I have a daughter roughly her age, right? The bank accounts that our children who are now in college, we have two college age kids, they don't live in the house anymore. They're close to Gabby Petito's age. They still use accounts that were set up by my wife and I when they were minors. And so we have access to those accounts. So my belief is that probably this account Gabby's had for a while, and that's why her parents knew about it. And they probably gave law enforcement access to the account from the very beginning, which is ultimately the reason they were able to issue an arrest warrant for Brian Laundrie. And the whole reason that they were able to indict him, that indictment was all done. Let me see if I can find that real quick. I'll show you. Here's the indictment. So that indictment is all because of the Capital One bank debit card and the accounts here. So yeah, I think they had their eye on that account from the very beginning, from September 11th. And that is another reason why I wonder why police didn't have Brian Laundrie under constant surveillance. Right? This case was taken over by the feds. This information would have gotten to them, I would hope. Of course it did. I mean, the indictment is there, right? Of course it got to the feds. The indictment is about this. And so the feds working with who they keep calling their partners in law enforcement, right? The Northport Police, Suffolk County Police out in Wyoming, everybody, this should have been communicated. So why they didn't have him under constant surveillance, whereas when I did my live stream a couple days ago, I wanted to give them the benefit of the doubt. Now that I see on the missing persons report that they had this information since September 11th, I think they probably should have kept him under constant surveillance from that point on. Unless... he was already gone by September 11th. I guess I will give them that out. But I'd love to know what you guys think. Man, this case just has so many twists and turns. I'm thinking about maybe putting on my website, making a Gabby Petito case page on my website and trying to get all of this documentation that I collect onto that one page so that people can see it easily. I also think I'm going to put a timeline together, and I know that people have timelines all over the place, but what I would like to do is probably build a crowdsourced timeline where we can put in things that are confirmed, things that are suspected and stuff like that, and maybe we could all work on it together. Let me know if you think that's a good idea in the comments below, and I might get busy on that. In the meantime, I guess I will bid you adieu for today, and I hope to see you on my next video. Take care, guys. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to my channel. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them below.